Now, for those of you who don't know, this is Evan.
Hey. Okay. I'm Evan. Alright, so I'm going to be talking about three manifolds today. There's going to be two sort of parts to the talk. One is going to be geometry, and I hope that one's very accessible. I'm going to make sure everyone gets that. And then there's algebra at the end, which is sort of necessary for combining a Turaev-Viro invariants, and it might be a little more technical, but I'm still going to try my best.
Just one thing I also. So don't hesitate to ask any questions if you have interrupted the speaker.
Yeah, absolutely, yeah. All right, so there's a few references for this subject. One really good one that's pretty fairly comprehensive is, so what is a three manifold? A three manifold is a space which locally looks like three-dimensional Euclidean space. Easy examples of this would be three-dimensional Euclidean space, because it looks like itself. A three-dimensional sphere, which would be given by the equation w squared plus x squared plus y squared plus z squared equals 1. So this is the analog of a sphere in three dimensions, which is one dimension higher. And if you're anywhere on the sphere, you can sort of project onto three-dimensional space. So if you're anywhere outside of this point that we projected from, where you are looks like three-dimensional space. So our three-sphere is another example. Projective space. This sort of looks like if you have a solid ball in, so this is like Berlin, you have a solid ball that's in 3 space, you can take every pair of opposite points on the boundary and glue them together, and the result will always look like three-dimensional Euclidean space locally. This is a bit impossible to visualize. You can sort of see why. If you have like a point here, you can draw a ball around it, which just looks like an open ball in Euclidean space. If you have a point here, drawing a ball around it will look something like that. So projective space is a three manifold. Another example would be the 3D torus. So that you basically just have three circles. So one way to write that down, well, the 2D torus looks like that, right? It's a donut shape. If you just have another circle, and you take a Cartesian product of that circle with this, then you'll have a three manifold. It always looks sort of locally like three dimensional space. All right, so quickly, the non-examples would be closed three ball and a closed solid torus. So that may seem odd because they're three-dimensional objects, but if we have the closed ball, for example, then we can take a point on the boundary, and any neighborhood of this boundary that we take will actually sort of look like a half space. So I sort of took like a plane and then took everything above it. That's what a neighborhood of a boundary point would look like. So these sort of closed solid objects that live in free space aren't actually three manifolds. They're called three manifolds with boundary, but we won't really detail them right now. Yes?
Question. So,
yeah.
When you say it looks globally like the three-dimensional Euclidean space, does that mean like for each point there is a sphere of positive radius that completely contained within the like the set of points that constitute the space?
Well, the thing with three-manifolds is they don't necessarily come with a metric, with a way of determining distance, so you can't necessarily define a ball around a point. Well, actually, interestingly, you can always give a three-manifold metric, but we can't sort of define them that way. The technical definition is that for every point, you have a neighborhood in a topological sense, which is homeomorphic to Euclidean free space, and that gives us a three-manifold. It's important that we make our three-manifolds compact, which sort of means that they don't go on forever. So, three-dimensional Euclidean space is actually ruled out because it goes on forever. But the three-dimensional sphere, projective space, and 3D torus, these are all candidates for study. Questions? Okay, so the way we're going to study three-manifolds is with these things called simple polyhedra. A simple polyhedron is a totally different kind of topological space where if you take any point and look sort of locally around that point at a neighborhood, you have three different possibilities. So let's look at what those possibilities are. One possibility, so you have your point, the neighborhood around it could look like this, just like an open disk. So that's pretty intuitive, just like a surface. Another possibility, however, is this. So it's sort of a Y shape. It sort of has like three planes coming together. Does everyone see what I drew here? Does that make sense? And then finally, the most sort of complicated case for what a neighborhood looks like is so here we go, like this. You have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 different planes coming together, and 4 different edges, and they all intersect at this point we call the vertex. And these are important. So what's interesting is that you can remove finitely many points from a compact three-manifold and then squish it into one of these things. So we call that a simple spine of the three-manifold. And just to go through some examples, if we have a projective space, well actually, if we have the three-sphere, right? The three-sphere is not too difficult to think about as projective space. So if you have just a two-sphere, you can think of that as a circle, and then a bunch of smaller circles sort of being stacked on top until it comes to a point, and on bottom, until it comes to a point on bottom. You can think of a three-sphere in the same way, as just two-sphere, and then a bunch of two-spheres stacked on top until they get smaller and smaller and smaller, and come to a point, as well as on bottom. Now, if you move the north and south pole from the three-sphere, you can sort of squish it this way, and squash it that way, and then basically you get a two-sphere. So this thing can be obtained from the three state, which is given by W squared plus C squared. And the way we obtain this is by moving two points and then squashing until we have this. And as you can see, we've sort of removed a dimension. Right? Squash away all the extra two spheres. Yeah?
By squash, you mean by conotropy equivalent?
A deformation tract, yeah. So there's a subspace. Every three manifold has a subspace which is homotopy equivalent to it, but with some points removed. The other example that I would give would be with the projective space. So we have that solid ball that I was talking about, except we have the typical points which are identified. Then, by the way, the way this is usually defined is take the set of all lines in four space and then sort of identify the lines as a single point. So if we think about it in three space, right, so these are our three axes, and they all actually correspond to single points in the projected plane, then draw some point like that, or sorry, some line like that. What we can do is draw a hemisphere in the upper half space of free space, like this. So this is a hemisphere. And notice that we'll have a bunch of lines going through the origin, which intersect this hemisphere exactly once, right? And then we'll also have this set of points which intersect the hemisphere twice. So what that tells us is that if we identify lines in three space which pass through the origin as points in their own space, then this can be obtained by taking a disk which corresponds to the hemisphere, and then just identifying the typical points on disk. So any pair of typical points will be identified. And then we'll get the projective plane. And that's sort of analogous to what we did with projective space, right? We took a solid ball and identified every typical point on the boundary. It should be noted that if we were to instead draw a sphere instead of a hemisphere, then every point, every line intersects exactly two points on the sphere. So if we were to consider the space made of lines passing through the origins of three space, it could be thought of as a two-sphere, but with all the typical points identified. Now, the reason I've mentioned that is because if we go back to projective space, we move a single point from the interior, sorry, from the interior of the three ball that we originally had, then we can expand it until all we're left with is the boundary, except with the typical points identified. So basically, if we remove one point from projective three space, we can retract it to get the projective plane. So those are both examples of spines of, or simple spines we call them, of three manifolds. And they're also both surfaces. As you noticed, we didn't have either of these types of points in those spines. So I want to give another quick example where we have that. So the three manifolds that I mentioned yesterday might have seemed a little complicated. So let's sort of return to the three sphere again, because that's sort of the simplest three manifold, simplest compact three manifold. If we remove a single point from the three sphere, we get Euclidean three space, right? Just by projection, just like if we have a two sphere and remove a point, we can sort of spread it out to the plane. So this is sort of an interesting thing to draw. Hopefully I can draw it off. Okay, so it's going to be a cube first. Notice that we can squash 3D space into a cube. And then what else we can do is this. So what I've done is basically I took a cube and then I sort of drilled a hole through the top and then hollowed out this bottom area, except I left this tunnel, or I drilled up and left a hollow area at the front. And this is a retract of the three sphere with a point removed. Do you see how I did that? Because we first started with a cube, which was a retract of the free space, and then we sort of dug this out, hollowed this out, and dug that out, and hollowed it out. And this has all types of neighborhoods. We have vertex, 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 vertex. We have like 8 vertices. So it's a more complicated retract in the three sphere, but it illustrates sort of what we could expect a spine, a simple spine, to look like. Yeah, does this make sense? Yeah.
Do you have like simpler spines?
Yeah. Yeah, no, remember, this the first retract of the three sphere that I mentioned was the two sphere. So that's a very simple example. This was actually made up to disprove some conjecture, but I forget what the conjecture was. So it sort of looks complicated, but it's just to illustrate that like spines can have all types of neighborhoods. Yeah.
So if you're standing on any point in that shape, can you walk to any other point, like in the interior or exterior of it?
So like you're being in three space, and you have you're like inside this space. This is called Big's house, by the way.
So, what is actually the definition of this simple spine? I mean, from a free sphere, you could remove one point and then it retracts to a point. So, it seems that there is no information in that.
Well, yeah, the three sphere is a very simple example. You can retract the three
sphere. So, would that be a simple spine? Is a single point at spine of
I don't three think that a single point is considered a spine, because we have to have that every point has a neighborhood, which is homeomorphic to one of these three cases.
What about just a disc?
A disc could work, but a disc has boundary. And boundary is sort of not nice in this story. Yeah. But yeah, a disc would work. You can just retract a three space to a compact disc, and then it would work. All right, so let's see. Okay, so obtaining a simple spine in general, you can always sort of like guess at which points to remove, and then just take a fraction like I did with getting the two sphere from the three sphere. But if we want to know that every three manifold has a simple spine, we have to have a general way of doing it. So the way this works is, first you have to know that every three manifold is triangulable, and this is not trivial thing to come by, so we just sort of accept it. And this means that any three manifold can be decomposed into a union of tetrahedra, so a union of these guys, such that they only intersect on their faces. So if we were to glue a tetrahedron to this tetrahedron, we would have to do something
cistern of that side?
Yeah.
Nice.
All right. So here we have a tetrahedron, and we also have an internal structure. So notice that the I'll give it a good angle. So the internal structure is just one of these vertices, right? We're going to have from each edge of the tetrahedron, of which there are six, comes a face, and they'll intersect at this single point. And from each face comes an edge. There are four faces, so there's going to be four edges. So basically what we do is we have our triangulated three manifold, and then we replace every tetrahedron with just one of these internal structures. And what happens then is that that will inevitably be a retract of the triangulation, but with the vertices of the triangulation removed. Because as you can see, this internal structure is just a retract of the tetrahedron with the vertices destroyed. Does that make sense? I'm going to move it around a little more if you want to see. Does that make sense? Yes.
So which of these three pieces is that correspond?
This one. Because we have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, and six edges which correspond to the six faces in this guy. So, all right, we're going to go back to the presentation. So we understand how to get a simple spline in general. So I want to talk briefly about the complexity of three manifolds. So the complexity is just the number of vertices in the spine, the simple spline of the three manifold, which has the least number of vertices. So we already saw some examples, right? With the three sphere, we can have a spine which has no vertices, the two sphere. We can have a spine with a projected three space, which has no vertices as well. So, if you're at all familiar with sort of geometry in three dimensions, these guys should look familiar. So we have S3, which is the three spherical geometry, which sort of means that as something grows, as its dimensions grow, volume grows very slowly, like it would on a sphere, except three-dimensional. We have Euclidean geometry, which is just flat. Nil is sort of unique to three dimensions. H2 cross R is the hyperbolic plane, Cartesian product with the line. And then we have H3, which is hyperbolic free space. So I think this is actually pretty interesting, because it's the complexity of a three manifold is sort of a combinatorial object, which sort of relates to triangulations and sort of that sort of thing, whereas geometry is continuous. And so there are a few just interesting things to note from this table, which is from Matveev, by the way. He has great figures. Every three manifold of complexity less than six is spherical, which means, like I said, that as some things, dimensions grow, as volume grows very slowly. And for hyperbolic manifolds, for H3, yeah.
What do you mean dimensions grow?
Oh, like if you have a two sphere, right? You have a point on the two sphere, and you have a ball around that point. It's specified by some radius r, right? As that radius increases, the area of the disk increases very slowly. It sort of increases in a similar way to the three-dimensional versions. You have to use different formulas because it's a different dimension. These geometries are exactly the ones that you guys were talking about with like prime three manifolds earlier. So notice, like I was saying, with spherical three manifolds, they're all, well, any three manifold with complexity less than six is spherical. And the least complex three manifolds with hyperbolic geometry have complexity 9. So this might, if you see this, this might provide some intuition that spherical manifolds are very simple and hyperbolic manifolds are very complicated. This turns out to be true. I think this is actually pretty good. I recommend that you guys read Matveev's book if you think it's me too. Okay, so why should we really care about spines? These are the Matveev moves. These are moves where we sort of take a spine, we look at local parts of it, and we can sort of do operations on those local parts. So if we have just a flat disk, flat plane like this, we can attach disk to it. So this is topologically distinct from that, just to be clear. This is like you have a bubble that's been placed on top of the plane. For this, we sort of start with a cylinder with a disk in the middle and two flanges, and we squeeze the disk to the middle, and we get rid of the vertices. It's called a loop move. And this is a T move, it's sort of like that, except you have three flanges, and we squeeze them all to just a segment, and then we end up with two vertices. Can everyone visualize these? Are the pictures clear? Yes.
In the bubble move, does the like area of the plane that's under the sphere get removed, or is it still there?
It's still there. So what the bubble move corresponds to is if you take some number of points from your three manifolds, take the retract, and then perform the bubble move, that means you have a retract of the original three manifold, except with an extra point removed. Because that extra point will create the bubble when you try to retract it. Okay. So this is why Matveev's moves are important. If you have a homeomorphism between three manifolds, meaning something where you can go one way without cutting or tearing and then come back without cutting or tearing, then you can decompose that homeomorphism using Matveev moves. Which basically means you can sort of remove some points, retract, perform some sequence of Matveev moves. It has to exist, it's guaranteed to exist by this theorem. And then thicken to get the three manifold, which is homeomorphic that you're looking for. If you were here for my talk last semester where I talked about Packer moves, these Matveev moves actually are Packer moves, performed on the dual. Right? With that tetrahedron I showed you, if you actually perform Packer moves on those tetrahedra and look at what happens to the internal structure, then you can recover the Matveev moves. And then plus the bubble move, which you have to get for removing an additional point. So that's pretty cool. Yes?
So if I start from this disk and add this bubble, then this outer space, which is not homeomorphic, the original one. So are you saying that it still corresponds to a homeomorphic free manifold?
Well, it's still a retract of the three sphere.
I see.
Yeah. You always have to thicken to get back to your original three manifold.
So you may have non-homeomorphic spines of homeomorphic manifolds. Can you have the other way around?
You have. That's a good question. I don't remember. I don't remember the answer. I don't. Homeomorphic spines of non-homeomorphic manifolds. If I had to guess, I'm not sure. No, I'm not sure. Good question. Okay, so now we're going to move on to the algebra part of this talk. This is what we need to actually sort of use the Matveev moves to distinguish between three manifolds. So we need to talk about commutative rings with unity. A commutative ring with unity is a set where you have sort of operations that act like addition and multiplication. You have associativity of both operations. You have the unit for both operations, and both operations commute. And you have distributivity and inverse for addition. Does everyone? I should start giving examples. The easiest example of a commutative root of unity is the integers. Satisfy all these properties in the integers, and that's just sort of something we all know, right? You can sort of verify them quite easily. Something that you might not have seen would be the integers mod n z. So if we have some, this is basically, for example, 5 equals 2 mod, what are we going to read? Yes, what? Sorry, do you have a question?
No.
Okay. Let's just pick an n. This ring has four different square roots of unity. It has these two, which as you can see, squared one, because 2 to the n minus 2 and 2 to the n are multiples of 2 to the n. And it also has plus or minus 1, which both squared one. So this ring has four square roots of unity. And yeah, that's something we're going to use in a sec. Okay. Okay, so we're going to talk about the algebraic initial data from Turaev-Viro invariants now. This is where it sort of starts to get a little, still a little technical, but stop me if you have questions. So we're going to need to fix a finite set of colors. We're just going to call them colors, because intuitively we're going to be coloring the faces of a simple spine. So I'm going to use the set 0, 1. My color is going to be 0, 1. So think of them as black and white, if you like. And then we need a set of triples. So we're going to have some I, J, K. these triples are going to have to satisfy some conditions. And I'm going to impose these conditions. I'm going to say that the conditions are as follows. This is sort of inspired by triangle inequality. You sort of have triangle inequality on all three of the elements of this triple, right? So possible triples which satisfy these conditions are 1, 1, 0, 0, 0, 0, or any permutation of this. So we actually only have four. Does anyone have any questions so far?
So I, J, K are from the columns.
Huh?
They're from the columns, like I,
yeah.
J, K.
Yeah. So, yes.
If 1, 1, 0 is, satisfies the condition, then for the, how does it satisfy the first equation? So 1 plus 1 is less than or equal to K, which is 0.
Oh, sorry, this is 1, 2.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, I should have wrote that, sorry. Yes, I'm just going to write one. Basically, all these conditions exclude is the triples where you just have 1, 1, and then 2 zeros. But we have, we always have 2 ones and then 1 zero, or just 0, 0, 0. Alright, so those are our triples. And the reason that they have to be closed under permutations is because we're sort of going to be thinking of these guys as coloring an edge, right? So I, J, and K are all going to be around an edge, and they have to be closed under permutation because we can always have a homeomorphism which sort of messes everything up. Okay. This is sort of optional. You can define a function called a weight, which takes a color and gives you an element in the ring that you choose. I'm just going to have the weights all be 1. So, but we do it as a WI, which is in R, the ring that we choose, and I is in I, which is our set of colors. Alright, oh, and what we do need actually is some fixed element of R, which is sort of a universal weight that doesn't have any index from the colors. Okay, so this is getting a little strange, but it's going to come together soon, promise. Okay, so we just need to get a little more initial data. So what we need to define next is called the 6J symbol, and basically we'll denote it as I, J, K, L, M, N. This is a function which takes 6 elements of the colors and lives inside the ring that we choose. The reason that it has, well, first of all, we have to have, if I just draw the vertex again, we have to have that every triple of colors around each edge going into the vertex is admissible. So that's what these conditions correspond to. These triples are just the colors around any edge which is going into the vertex. And then what these symmetries correspond to at the bottom are just tetrahedral symmetries. So rotations and reflections that sort of preserve the position of the tetrahedron. So you can always have a homeomorphism which sort of messes with the positioning of all the faces. So we want the 6J symbol to have these symmetries. Is everyone with
with me so far?
Okay, so the triple is admissible if it satisfies those qualities,
right,
and also permutation.
Right.
Okay, yeah.
Well, actually, the admissibility is just this.
That's
the admissibility is something that you impose.
Right.
The closed limit permutation is something you need. You, so when you're defining your own, Turaev-Viro invariants are a class of invariants. So this initial data is always up to you. You just have to sort of do what we're about to do next to verify that it's actually an invariant. So this is the definition of the invariant. It looks weird. Hopefully it doesn't look scary. But basically, you just sum over every coloring, we're going to say phi is a coloring of the simple spine of your three manifold, and it's admissible, meaning every edge has three admissible colors around it. And we're going to take the squared weights of every color of every face, and we're going to also multiply by the 6J symbol of all the colors around a given vertex. Oh, and then we have this this out here, which is sort of for normalization. Basically, what happens is that for every admissible coloring, we take product of the squared weights of every face, and we take the product of every 6J symbol of every vertex. We do that for every invisible color and sum.
Could you go one step back?
Yeah. Does anyone have any questions?
So what is the 6J symbol?
The 6J symbol is a function. It takes six colors and outputs an element of your ring.
Just any function?
It has to satisfy those symmetries. The reason it satisfies the symmetries is because they're tetrahedral symmetries, which sort of preserve. Because this thing has tetrahedral symmetry. So.
Give an example of the six-J symbol function.
Yes, I should absolutely do that. Okay, I'm going to go over here. So, with the triples that we have defined, we actually only have three 6J symbols that we need. We need 0, 0, 0, 0, 0. Alright? And I'm just going to set this equal to 1. Okay? So maybe that looks dumb, but I like it. This is the other one of the other two that we need to symmetry. You can sort of verify that this. All the edges going into this vertex would be invisible. And I'm also going to set this equal to 1. And finally, we have this guy. And I'm going to set this equal to 2 to the n minus 1 plus or minus 1. So remember that the ring that I'm working with is the integers modulo 2 to the n. So this squares to 1. It's going to be sort of the order. So does everyone see this example? The reason we only need to define these is because every other possible 6J symbol with our conditions is symmetric to this.
Is the for the admissibility, is the 1, 1, 1, like how is that admissible on the bottom?
You don't actually need that LMN is admissible. So these are the four triples that you need to be admissible. They correspond to the four edges going in to the vertex here. So this guy, and this guy. We need the colors around these edges to be admissible. And that's what we have here. So 0, 0, 0 is admissible, and then 0, 1, 1, 1, 0, 1, 1, 1, 0 are all admissible.
And could you label the faces so I could see how those true
correspond
to the edges?
Yeah, good idea. I'll draw a bigger picture.
Okay. after the talk if you don't have enough time.
I'm going to do it real quick. So opposite indices will be opposite faces. So I, L, J, M, K, N. Cool. So this object is called the state sum, and it's the value of the Turaev-Viro invariant. It's actually, with these initial conditions, it's actually pretty simple to calculate because you only have like a, you'll only have like a few admissible colorings, and then like a few vertices you need to calculate the situation for. Okay, so real quick, we need to talk about how with these with the state sum on a simple spine, the Matveev moves impose algebraic equations. So this is the bubble move. Actually, for the initial data. Remember that we had like one edge on one side of the bubble move, which is just sort of where the bubble intersected the plane, and then no vertices or anything on the other side. This corresponds to the balloon move. So remember, on one side of the balloon move, we had two vertices, which correspond to these two 6J symbols. On the other side, we didn't have anything except two edges. And then this is the T move, which takes us from three vertices to two vertices. So those equations are difficult to work with, in my experience. What I sort of figured out over the summer is that all you need, if you want to be like lazy sort of, you just need this, this, and the third one needs to square to one. And then anything that does that will satisfy those three equations that I just showed you. And therefore the state sum will be invariant. Meaning, since it won't change under the Matveev moves, it'll be a topological invariant. It'll stay the same under any homeomorphism that you apply. Okay, so this was when I was going to perform an example calculation, but I don't think we have enough time for that, so I'm going to provide some example values for this invariant. Okay, so these spaces are all spherical manifolds, just meaning they're sort of like you took a three-sphere and then sort of folded it on itself. It's the quotient of a three-sphere by a group action. So the state sum, regardless of which square root of unity you choose, is 2 for L41, which is a certain three manifold. And regardless of the square root of unity that you choose, the state sum for S3 mod Q8, which is the quaternion group, is 4, regardless of the square root of unity. And for this one, it's always 1, L5-2. So that's basically what I'm getting at, is that regardless of which square root of unity that I chose, the calculation never depended on it. For this quotient manifolds, the state sum was 5. Didn't matter which square root of unity I chose for the calculation. And for this one, it was 2. These are very nice figures, by the way. I really like this book. He has some good figures. So these manifolds that I showed you here were all spherical. I calculated it for one more manifold, which was the Klein ball times the circle, and I got 2. And it also didn't depend on the square root of unity. So that was basically, I haven't found a three manifold for which this specific example that I've given here actually depends on this, on what you choose for this last six-j symbol. The reason being is that whenever you have an admissible coloring of the three manifolds that I showed you, this six-j symbol always shows up an even number of times. So if you, you know, square it, it goes to one, so it's not fun. And then just one more slide, possible future directions for where you could take this. Is this value actually, is the value of this invariant actually independent of the square root that you choose? If so, why? Why would there always be an even number of this 6j symbol in any admissible coloring for any retract of a three manifold? If not, for which manifolds does the choice matter? For the, remember that table that I showed you earlier, there were 61 manifolds complexity less than 6, and they're all spherical. I calculated this only for 5 spherical manifolds and then 1 Euclidean manifold, which was the Klein-Ball lattice 1. So it would be interesting maybe if manifolds of a different geometry had sort of non-trivial values for this invariant. If it doesn't matter which square of unity that you choose, maybe the definition of the invariant can be weakened by incorporating weights, perhaps. So we still get some simple equations, like the fact that this just has a square of 1, and it's still an invariant. Or maybe there are other rings that we should look at. Most Turaev-Viro invariants have either been defined in the complex numbers or these things called quantum algebras. Viro, who does work here by the way, I don't know if you've met him, but Viro wanted me to sort of look in simple solutions. So I looked in finite rings and found this, but it's not very exciting. Maybe there are slightly more interesting rings where something a little more interesting could be found. Does anyone have any questions? Yes.
So you say like all of the Turaev-Viro invariants with this ring are like this?
No. I couldn't figure out what all possible Turaev-Viro invariants are for this ring specifically, because, well, that would be a pretty difficult search. There would be quite a few possibilities like this, and then plus weights. This is just something that I happen to notice. I happen to notice that if you plug in one for this, and one for this, and one for all the weights, the only restraint left is that this 6j symbol has to square of 1. That's the only restriction posed that's left after those definitions. Did you have a question?
So this definition of the Turaev-Viro invariant on your slide, you had the main state sum, so this sort of suggests that this quantity is actually connected somehow to quantum field theory. Is that?
Yes, but I don't know how. My physics knowledge is lacking. Viro, probably not. You could ask him.
Kirillov, too. He's written a paper on that. Kirillov. Yeah, I was looking it up. Right.
Alexander Kirillov, he also works here.
Kirillov?
Yeah. Yeah, but I don't know. Apparently, there's some interesting connection to like scattering theory, but I don't know it. I don't know physics very well. Is there any other questions?
So, like, could you explain how you? I mean, I'm sure you explained, but how you go from a three manifold to a spine? Like, what's that in that?
So the map can actually be done, it's in Matveev, there's like a nice proof in Matveev. It's pretty interesting because what you actually do is you remove open balls, and first you have like some triangulation sort of thing, some piecewise linear thing. And then you remove some open balls, and it turns out you can actually do it combinatorially by like actually removing like solid pieces until all that's left is the simple spine. So no explicit math is given, but you can actually remove things until you have it. And the way to remove things is sort of given by that figure that I showed, right? Yeah, I'll actually bring it up again. So if you have a three-dimensional that's broken up into tetrahedra, then you can sort of just remove these chunks, these four chunks from every tetrahedron. What you'll be left with log to be a spine. So no math, but there's sort of a nice way to do it.
Are there any more questions? All right, well, thank you very much.